No point. Last week's one didn't do us any good. The number of views halved. And we lost another subscriber, though we did pick another one up. And great to have you here. Welcome aboard. So we're still net zero on the subscriber front. Well, obviously that is still the plan, but I'm not ready to do that yet. And more importantly, version 11 isn't ready for me to do that yet. So in the meantime, we race and we use a bit of TM1 to do it. You know, that has been the plan of every Australian Prime Minister for the last 10 years. And if I did that, I'd be a politician, not a motorsport manager. And I'm no politician. Roll the tape. Welcome back, or welcome for the first time, to TM1 Bytes Weekend Edition, where we are on part 5 of Motorsport Manager and are finally doing our first race. I will admit, perhaps one of the reasons for the length of past episodes is that I haven't been looking forward to doing this, because the races go for about 30 minutes in real time if you let them run at 1-to-1 time, which of course we won't. And while I can do 5 minutes of improv without falling over my own tongue, 30 minutes is a little bit more of a stretch. I have never tried anything like this before, so we shall just see how we go. At the end of the last episode, we had just finished our practice session. Now, we couldn't finish it properly in the sense that the practice session finished before we could get the cars back into the pits and see what the drivers' reactions were. That is actually okay, because I want them out there for as long as possible, and we can still check the reactions now, as we shall. One of the most important things about the practice session is that it gives you the opportunity to obtain special knowledge. So you can see that we have 4 slots here for special knowledge for both of the drivers. So if we go to the first one, we obtain 2 items of knowledge from our practice session. Soft tyres, which gives us a 10% performance increase, and race trim, which gives us a 10% performance increase. And this is why I said in the last episode, you need to try to make sure that you practice on the tyres that you're going to race on. Now, I haven't shown you, but I've looked at the weather forecast, and it looks like it's going to be dry for this session. So we're going to go out on soft tyres, which is fine. We are currently set up to use ultra softs. We'll just confirm that for a moment. Okay, so for some reason, both of them have been put on ultrasofts. Supersofts, not ultrasofts. I don't want to send them out on supersofts because, first of all, I'll lose that 10% performance increase. And secondly, I don't think they can make supersofts last for a decent amount of time. Now, this is the first thing that you have to do as a team manager. Actually, we'll come back to that after we add Faith's slots, which are exactly the same ones. Okay, so she gets a 20% performance bonus. One of the first things that you have to do as a team manager is work out a pitting strategy. Now, you need to be adaptable about this because circumstances may change. There may be a crash, in which case you may have the opportunity to pit while everybody's queued up behind the safety car, or there may be a change in the weather, or it may be that somebody hits one of your cars and damages a component, or actually a part rather than a component, and you have to pull them in. But generally, you need to lay out exactly when you are going to pit your drivers. Now, this race is 26 laps, if I remember correctly, and you can have 12 laps worth of fuel. Be aware, that is 12 laps worth of fuel at a standard fuel consumption rate. So if you tell your drivers to push, the fuel amount is going to be lower. You need to keep an eye on the fuel gauge. So, the next thing is the car setup. So on the practice session, we had Gomez and Anthony give us feedback. The last feedback that we had, the one that we didn't get a chance to see after the practice session, had Gomez happy with both speed, balance and downforce, and thinking that handling was excellent. Faith considers that downforce and handling are both great, and speed balance is excellent. Fastest lap 128.325, 128.048, which is 4 seconds off the pace, which is why we're going to get slaughtered. I knew it was going to happen. We'll just live with it. Change the setup. Okay. Now, great, excellent, great. Optimum balance 95%. I am not going to monkey around with this and try and get it to 100%. First off, because we may end up going the wrong way. Second off, there's no real advantage in doing it. So I am actually going to save that configuration, and I'm going to use it as Gomez Black CF. And that way, if I ever need it, I can just load that setup again. In reality, oh, this is actually 30 laps, sorry. 12 laps of fuel, 30 laps for the race session. In reality, we will probably never use that setup again, because obviously the car is going to be different the next time we're back here, if we ever are back here. Probably the driver will be different too, you never know. Okay, tyre choice is definitely not going to be super softs. Now, that's the set that he practiced on. We're obviously not going to use those because they're down to about 25%. We'll put on a fresh set of softs. If he even has to do 3 pits, we've got plenty of tyres. This is a full set of tyres. So we've got plenty of tyres for the weekend. It's up at the higher levels that you can have a problem. Now, previously, in previous games, I have always sent them out with a fuel load. Generally, it's the tyres that are the determining factor in when I bring them in. But I may need to change that with this new Devils in the Detail pack. Because of the emphasis on weight now, obviously fuel is the quickest way to save some weight. So I'm going to have to think about that, but we'll just see how we go. That shows you how long it takes to put a lap's worth of fuel into your car during a pit stop. Okay, so I'm going to confirm him, and for Faith, she's at 97%. Again, there is no way that I am going to monkey with that. Anthony Black CF. Okay, that'll do. Confirm. I might change those names later if I have the opportunity, but I'm not going to worry about that. You can see here, you now have a button load set up, so you can actually go there and find the setup that you want. Tyre choice is obviously going to be... Hello, that's interesting. Okay, she's going to be on softs. What I noticed there, though, was that her tyre usage is slightly greater than Gomez's was. And they would have been driving in pretty much the same style for pretty much the same length of time in practice. So that means that when I do my pit stop plan, I'm probably going to bring her in first and get her out on a new set of tyres. And then I'll do Gomez. I'm going to send them both out with 12 laps of fuel. Confirm that. The next thing is the driver strategy. Now, we looked at this briefly in practice last week. So the driving style is either back up. Okay, I'm not sure what they mean by back up there. Conserve, which is where you're trying to conserve your fuel and conserve your car at all costs. Well, conserving fuel is over there on the engine mode, rather. Down there on the engine mode. Neutral is what it suggests. Push, so attack is really going after everybody and really pushing the accelerator down and trying to get your wheels up around everybody, and it's going to take a heck of a lot out of your tire. Your tire wear will go up, so those little triangles there are indicating what your tire wear is going to be. But at the start of the race, I want to get some heat into the tires, so I'm going to set that to push. And I'm also going to set the fuel burn to push. Generally speaking, this is how I start a race. I just push it up to push in both cases, push and high. So the engine modes are low, medium, high, and overtake. Continue. And then it shows you the starting grid, which I don't care about. Continue. Oh, heck, I just realized something. I forgot to turn the sounds back on. Preferences, audio settings. Main volume, 25% will do. Continue. Gomez, 18th. The good part is he can only drop 2 places. There's really not much you can do in this first lap, so I just speed it up. Now we've got 12 laps of fuel for both of them. Anthony goes through tyres faster, so I'm thinking we'll pull Anthony in on lap 10 and we'll pull Gomez in on lap 11. The main reason for that is you do not want to stack your drivers up in the pit lane, otherwise they will end up being stuck behind each other. Now, I am going to show you something. We're just going to pause here for a little moment. Okay, you see this down here. We looked at this a little bit in the practice session. This wheel essentially shows you the type of tyre that you're using, which is soft in this case. You'll notice that the field is pretty evenly split between super soft and soft. The guys who have the better cars can risk running on super softs, but you will notice that they are probably chewing through those just a little bit faster than the other guys, the guys who run soft. Okay, the wheel around here, the black area shows you how much the tyre has been degraded. So you can see that that's at 87%. Faith is at 86%. Faith has dropped back to 20th place. What a surprise. Over here, we have a rather important little gauge, which is the tyre heat. Okay, displays the current tyre temperature. The higher the temperature, the more strain is put on the tyre wear. True, but the tyres do need to be warm, just as they do in real life, to be able to work properly. They have an optimal temperature. Tyres also heat up at different air temperatures. That's not really such a problem for us, at least not here in the Black Sea, because you can see that we have 20 degrees Celsius. I have no idea what that is in Fahrenheit. I'll put a little note over the top for those who are still in any country that uses Fahrenheit, which is one of them. Well, two, I think. But so 20 is actually not very hot. That's not going to be a major problem for us. So getting back over to here, tyre wear, tyre temperature. Softer compounds will start heating up at lower air temperatures than harder compounds. Now the needle at the moment is roughly in the center. This has changed in the Devils in the Detail Pack. Previously, you basically had a graduated series of zones. So you had a low zone, a medium zone, and a high zone. Now you do need to get the tire temperature just up a little bit above the middle there, or at least you did in the old game. This now seems to be divided into four chunks, which represent specific temperature ranges rather than just a gradient as it did in the older game, in the older version of the game. This is also a question of some considerable dispute amongst Motorsport Manager players, the question of whether leaving your tyres cold has any effect. Now, there's something that happens to tyres called graining, and it occurs, amongst other times, when you push a tyre too hard, which hasn't been heated up to its optimal operating temperature. And it's essentially like little bits of rubber come off, well, they don't actually come off the wheel, and that's part of the problem. It's like getting balls on a woolen jumper. And essentially, as you go around the track, these balls will eventually get ripped off, and they'll take part of the rest of the tyre with it. And so you get increased tyre degradation. Now, some people claim that if you leave your tyres too cold, the game simulates that by causing increased tyre wear. Other people claim that's not the case. As with everything else, it's almost impossible to measure because not all things are going to be equal in two races, and the devs haven't actually spoken up about whether they have modelled this. But generally speaking, you should try to keep the tyre temperatures just a little bit above the mid-range. That seems to be where they work the best. This will also be affected by the number of stars for tyre heating that your chassis has. The more stars that you have, and this has been confirmed by the devs, the longer a tyre will remain in the optimal heating zone. When you get all the way up into this hot zone, the tyres start to lose effectiveness. They will wear faster, and also you will not get as much of a benefit from pushing the tyres, because obviously they don't have anywhere to go. They will get hotter as you push them. So that's why you can't just go out on a strategy of, yeah, push it all the way, overtake, attack, attack, attack. It doesn't work, because that's going to be the penalty that you have. So you have to watch out for the tyre temperature and try to make sure it's in the normal range. And you also have to watch out on the fuel gauge. So the fuel gauge tells you how many laps there are to go, but always take that with a grain of salt, because it's how many laps to go if you are on normal fuel use. If you increase the fuel use, and I've got both of these guys running on high engine mode, so they're burning fuel at a more prodigious rate, then that is actually not going to last you 10.38 laps. So you cannot rely on that. You have to keep an eye on it. You have to make sure that you pull your people into the pits as and when you need to. Up here, this standings, there is actually a whole lot more information that you can get out of that, although I don't know whether you can get it when it's paused. So it shows you the type of tyre that they are on, it shows you how many pit stops they've done, and it shows you the gap to the leader. So in our case, Anthony is 12.2 seconds behind. Why is that? Because Anthony is doing laps at 131.407. These guys, well, even the ones in front of Gomez, 129.147. So we're going to be falling further and further behind. There's nothing more we can do with the car. It's as good as we can get it, and that's not very good. So I'm just going to unpause that, and we shall resume. Okay, now let me see if I can bring this up. I'm sure there used to be more information here. Oh, here we go. Yeah, if you hover over that, you'll get greater information. So this will give you information about their tyres, number of stops, gap to leader, last lap is the most important thing. So Jahar is doing 126.259. What's that? I can't get past Mello. You can't get past your own... Never mind. He's doing... Okay, he's on a normal strategy. He's burning a little more fuel than usual. The AI drivers seem to change rapidly. See those lights blinking on and off? Whereas we've just been sitting on that for a while now, which means that I need to check my tyre temperatures. Okay, I'm going to bring them back to a neutral stance on the tyres, and that should prevent them from overheating. We've got 9.07 laps remaining. Lap 30, okay, so that's fine. Hello, what's this? What's this? Pit. I don't know what that emblem is. I haven't seen that before. That must be something new. Unless he's had a mechanical breakdown or something. What on earth is going on? He went into the pits. Is he still there? Is he still racing? What's going on? No, he's back out on the track because you can see the gap is closing. Okay, so this gap over here is the gap to the person in front of them. And in Anthony's case, 0.78, 0.79, so she's falling back. She's managing to hold off El Sadat. I do not know what that was. What happened with El Sadat, why he dropped back like that. Okay, we have the championship standings. Really, that is not something that we're interested in looking at the moment. And the same thing with the team championship standings. Not important. I'm struggling to overtake Mello. Just do something. Do some of that driver stuff. The track's divided up into three sectors. And really, I don't find this particularly useful. I've never been able to figure out a way of making use of that. In fact, yeah, even in practice, it makes no sense to me because you don't know which sectors the track is divided up into, so it seems irrelevant. Sponsor objective off target. So that's telling us that the target that we're going for our bonus sponsor, we have to be 13th or above to get that money. And the fact that we are currently 18th and 19th means that we are below that sponsor objective. What a surprise. Weather forecast you must always keep an eye on, and in fact I've been a little bit tardy about this because I've been talking to you guys. So down here you can see that the temperature is pretty much standard all the way through. You're going to be getting a little bit of cloud next lap, you're going to be getting a little bit of sun after that. There's no indication of rain. What's she saying? Staring back at this Gomez for three laps. Well, yeah, both of you are staring at the back of pretty much everybody. Okay, so you can see how far out you can see the weather forecast. This is a little bit unrealistic. If you have a weather forecasting center in your... Aha! Anthony's just overtaken Gomez. Big whoop. If you have a weather forecasting center in your headquarters, you can see further out than this. This is a bit unrealistic because a lap only takes you a handful of maybe 1 minute 30 seconds, or in Anthony's case, 1 minute 30 seconds. In the case of Gomez, 1 minute 32. So that's unrealistically short. I don't know what it's like in the Black Sea, but I can tell you here, I can see a rainstorm coming a heck of a lot sooner than something like 4 minutes away. Still, that's what you've got, and you need to be aware of it. Keep your eye on it. Make sure that you're aware if the weather is going to change, and you may need to change to wet weather tires. Water on track. There is no water on track at the moment because there's no rain. That's fine. Track grip. Okay, you see how that's increasing. What that is, as the cars go around the track, they lay down rubber, and the rubber will make the track grippier, and it should, in theory, make them faster. So when it rains, the rain washes away that rubber, and that will reduce the track grip. Data center will have to come back to, because I'm planning to pull Faith in on lap 10, and we're already up to lap 8. So this map here is a mini map of the track. It's extremely useful. You need to be across how to use that one. So the checkered line is over here, but the pit entrance is way back here. So if you're going to pull them into pit, you need to make sure that you do it no later than about here. In this particular track, obviously it's different in the other tracks. So Anthony is still on lap 8. I'm going to increase the speed a little bit because we don't need to watch her lose. Oh hell, she's in 13th place. Why? Because all these people have gone into the pits at least once and she hasn't. So that gives her a little bit of a bonus. Starting to struggle with the tire wear. I'm just going to slow that back down again so I can talk to you about that for a moment. And see, she's on 28%. Gomez is on 30%. So that's actually more like what I was expecting and why I had planned to pull Anthony in on lap 10. The point at which you start having problems... Hang on, where's Anthony at the moment? She is on lap 9. Okay. The point at which you start to have problems depends in part on what sort of tyre compound you're on. Now, some people say if you get to 25%, you're dead in the water. She's going to have to pit. Oh, my lord. Hang on, we could have a problem. Okay, so in the pit stop, it's okay because the time is paused, so I'm not actually losing anything at the moment. You select what sort of tyres you want to replace her existing tyres with, if you do, which we do because obviously she is down. You have no changes queued. Yes, I know that. I haven't done anything yet. So I'm going to put her out on a new set of softs, fuel options. I'm going to bring it up to the top again. Part condition we have to really, really watch because you can see that these parts have degraded massively already. So the engine's down to 54%, 53%, and this isn't even the car that we sacrificed a lot of performance on. So the rear wing was at 80%, I sacrificed 5% for weight, so it brought it back to 75, and it's already dropped by 20 percentage points. This is the first lap, I would say, first pit stop, sorry. I would say that we are going to have big problems by the end of this race, but we should be okay for the moment. Pit strategy. Pit strategy is how fast you want to try to take this pit stop. Most of the time you want to go for a balanced pit stop. You've got a risk of 18% of a mistake being made. A fast one might save you 2 seconds, but you've got a 34% chance of a mistake being made. A safe pit stop is 8%. A lot of this is going to depend on the pit stop skill and the concentration skill of your mechanic. So this is plus 2 seconds compared to doing a safe pit stop. I'm prepared to take that risk. Estimated pit stop time is 15 seconds. That's fine. Bring her in. So she's now got an icon over there, which is indicating that she'll be pitting on the next lap. Now, he's still on high fuel burn. That could end up being a problem. Where is he on the track? Oh, he'll be on vapor when he comes in. I'll still risk it. Okay, I will talk to you about the... I'll talk to you about the tyre wear once we've done the pit stops. Okay, so I've just sped that up to maximum speed. And now I'll bring it back down. So Anthony is coming into the pits. So that means that I now have to tell Gomez it's his turn to come in. So I'm going to hit him on the pit. His tyres are going to be even in a worse state than Anthony's, which is unfortunate. I didn't think he'd get through them that fast. You see that he is really, really going to be on vapor. In fact, I may even have to tell him to slow it down a little bit. His part condition is holding up moderately well, except for his engine. I think there is a danger that he's going to have problems with the engine. The question is whether I fix it now to boost up the reliability a little bit, or whether I leave it until later. Frankly, I think if it's below 48%, or if below 50%, then I need to get the mechanics to look at it. Unfortunately, that's going to mean a pit time of 30 seconds, which means we'll be close enough to attack El Sadat. He's going to end up at the tail of the field. There's no real way around that. We cannot go on with an engine that's under 50%. Okay, so I'll tell him to pit, and I'll also tell him to, no, not his driving style, go to low usage on the fuel, which is going to slow him down a lot. But I don't want him running out of fuel. At the moment, he's only got 0.67 laps, and he's probably just a smidge over that in terms of how long he's got to get around to the pit stop. So I should have actually taken him off higher fuel usage earlier, but I was talking to you lot, so that's my excuse. Okay, so he's coming in, he'll just make it. He's got 0.19 laps of fuel to go. I'm going to change his strategy back. So I'm going to send him out with medium engine usage. This is bad. Anthony's on 20th, but she'll come round. Now he's on 20th. That's what I expected. However, that gets his engine reliability up to 70%. So hopefully, nice, the engine is feeling way better now. So it should cost us 15 seconds and put you in last place. Okay, so what I was talking about with the tire wear, you can see that that's at 89%. Now, there is a school of thought that if you get below 25%, you are toast. In reality, a tire actually has four zones. So you've got a new tire, and then you've got a relatively new tire, and then you've got a tire that's starting to get worn, and then you've got a dead tire. And the percentage points at which they pass through those zones, each one obviously is a little bit slower than the one before it. The percentage points at which they pass through those zones, and if you get to a dead tire, you start to get hit with massive lap time penalties. It varies according to the compound. So a dead tire for a soft is likely to happen earlier than it is for, say, a medium. But the rule of thumb is try to avoid getting under 25%. For a soft, you can actually probably get under 25% just and still not be in the dead zone. For a super soft, I don't think you're going to get much under 25% before you are really getting impacts on your lap times. And for an ultra soft, doubly so. Okay, Anthony, what you got on that green one? The green one indicates that, what does it, grey square? Green indicates a new personal best. Yay, she's done a personal best for two. Oh, no. Oh, I didn't see that coming. There's no reason why Gomez should have crashed. Crashing will generally occur if you're really pushing the car, but I had Gomez on neutral settings. So there is no reason why he should have crashed. His reliability on all of his parts was pretty decent. He is actually not a completely awful driver. But this is the first time I think I've had one of my drivers crash. I've seen plenty of other ones crash. Okay, now, Faith has given me the opportunity to tell you about something else. The rules of the competition can determine what sort of safety car is used. So you can have a physical safety car, which is where a little yellow Porsche comes out and drives around in front of everybody, and everybody queues up at the back of it. Okay? And that means that whoever was in the lead loses their lead. And so some people think that the physical safety car is a bit unfair. In other competitions, you can have a rule which states that there is a virtual safety car. So what happens then is that you don't have a safety car come out in front of the pack, but there is an electronic control that takes over the engine and keeps the separation between the cars. ERS currently uses a physical safety car. So that means that everybody is going to bunch up. Anthony is asking me, do you want to pit with the safety car out? And what that means is she can pit now when everybody is being forced to drive slowly and lose less time over the rest of the pack. And the answer to that is, in this case, yes, we're going to pit now. Take new tyres, get a full load of fuel, and we'll check the part condition. The engine is under spec, so this is possibly a blessing for us. It would be a blessing if a driver from another team crashed. It's not so much a blessing for us that one of our own drivers crashed. 45% is low on the gearbox as well. How can that possibly have fallen to 48%? Okay, I'm going to do all of those, and that's going to be 48 seconds. So, go. Okay, so where is she? Oh, she's going to have to do most of a lap anyway. One lap left on the safety car. That's basically a lap's worth of stuff. Ah, sorry guys, really sorry, that was pathetic. Yes, it was pathetic! That was my car! What have you done to my car? There goes my no-claim bonus. Okay, so I'm going to speed this up again. We're at lap 15. Faith is not going to get as much of a benefit out of this as I had hoped. But it'll give us an opportunity to do the engine and the other two components. She's actually not getting a bad pit stop here. That actually was not a horrible pit stop. Okay, so she's come out. Seems to be in much better condition. Yep, okay. Her engine mode is high. I'm going to leave her on high for a little bit. And best of all, Gomez crashed in our best car. Better car. The better car. I hesitate to use either better or best because, really, that's a relative term. Okay, so it looks like some other people took the opportunity to do a pit as well because a lot of them have got two on the pit stops. And some of them have come back out on super softs. Now, Beauchamp and Dreyfus, they've both got a lot of tyre usage, and so does Johnsdottir. Okay. How are her lap times now? 1:50, that doesn't count, because she's been on a pit stop, so you're obviously going to get a slower time on that. I need to get a clean lap time on her. 1:53... ...9.23 laps worth of fuel left. Come on, Faith, get around. I want to see what times you're doing. Go, Faith, go. Lap 17. 1:34. That's pathetic. 1:34 is pathetic. Last lap is no real indication because obviously everybody was stuck behind the safety car for a while there. Oh, hang on. 1:34. 1:34 is pathetic. Okay, last lap was actually 1:30. Okay, so that's not good. It's still 4 seconds, 5 seconds off the pace. Right, data center. This is going to pause the game for a little bit. The data center will actually show you little skull. Yeah, that's pretty much summarizes it. This shows you a heck of a lot of information. So you've got live timings. So that'll give you the times around the sectors, which I don't really care about because I don't understand what the sectors are. The time for the laps, which is actually what is really more important. And also the gap to leader, the gap, number of pit stops, fastest lap. fastest lap is probably the most important thing. So Faith's fastest lap is 1:33.54. And can we sort this? No, we can't sort this. That's unfortunate. The first place getter at the moment, Sabado, their best lap is 1:24. So she's a full 6 seconds off the pace. There is actually nobody who is getting laps in or has a best lap in the 130s other than us. So, okay, so that's the data center. A lot of information. You'll see it at the end as well. And the commentary feed is probably less important. Standings, we certainly don't need to see at the moment, and we'll just go back to the race. What's happened here? Why has everybody stopped? Go. Oh, no. Okay, for some reason it paused there. When I went into the data center, it probably paused it. I've never seen it need to be manually reactivated there, though. Okay, so we're on lap at 20 out of 30. Faith is also on lap 20. She has 5.82 laps of fuel remaining, so she's going to have to put in at least one more pit stop. I'm going to tell her to really start pushing it. It's probably not going to make a blind bit of difference, but we're going to bring her in around about lap 25, I think. And she'll need 5 laps of fuel. Call it 9 laps of fuel if I tell her to keep pushing the engine. And we'll give her a fresh set of tyres as well. See what she can do with those. I'm partially tempted to put her on super softs, but that's going to sacrifice that 10% performance bonus. But on the other hand, the 10% performance bonus doesn't seem to have been doing anything. Hello! She's actually gotten under 130. 129.471 for a last lap. Oh, way to go. Oh, and she's starting to pick up places. I don't think she's going to pick up 13th. You see here, we've got our sponsor objective here as well. It shows you visually how far off she is. Lap 24. She's still on lap 23. She's going to lose all of those places when I pull her into the pits. Okay, fuel options. 9. Okay, so that should do. Part condition should see us through. The suspension's at 48, but we've only got 5 laps to go. Brakes are at 44. Pit strategy, 34% is too high a risk. Okay, so we'll just go with an estimated pit stop. So she should be exiting at 18th, and she can keep on fanging it. I think I need to keep... stop pushing, guys. My tyre dig is through the roof. Your tyre dig is through the roof, but as soon as you hit the pit lane, you're going to be getting a new set of tyres. So she's up here at the moment. So she'll be coming into the pit lane now. So far, so good. Refueling's okay. That was a good pit stop. She's coming out in 17th. Okay, so that's one place ahead of where we thought she might be. She's got fresh tyres. Unfortunately, the people ahead of her also have relatively fresh tyres. So what are they doing at the moment? Ooh, they're really pushing it. Okay, what have we got? Yeah, she can go for it. Just push it to the wall. Now again, that runs the risk of her crashing as well, but less so because at least this is a dry track. She's got fresh tyres. And she's not a complete and utter idiot, unlike Gomez and his hairstyle. I don't think she's got a hope in heck of getting 13th unless those other three crash out. Does anybody have a set of tacks that I can spread over the track in front of Rogers and Marquetta? I'm going through those tyres like a fat guy goes through hot dogs. That's a line that you'll see frequently in this game, and they really need to get a new line. They could have actually done something with that in the Devils in the Detail Pack, but they obviously didn't. How are her lap times? 1:28.265. Okay, so she's really going hell for leather on it. She's 13 seconds off Rogers. And there are... Oh, no. Give it up. Give it up. It's only one lap to go. Well, this was a disaster. This was a complete and utter disaster. She'll finish in 17th place. There's no way she'll make up that 14 seconds unless Rogers crashes out. And put us out of our misery, Faith. Get across the checkered flag. Oh no, she's still got one lap to go. Doesn't matter, she's closing the gap. She's closing the gap at 12.46. But she's already got her tyres down to 22%, so... Oh, and the temperature's through the roof. So that's actually not going to be having any impact anymore, pushing the tyres like that. Doesn't matter. It's over. We really need to be doing better than this. You are telling me this like I do not know. Winner, Eastwood Motorsport European Racing Series. Well, at least we didn't finish last, but the team will be last because Gomez crashed out. So that's the pattern of tyre history. I don't know why they show you that. What's more important is the lap charts. So that gives you a whole wealth of information. I look at Faith's. I look at Faith, I'm getting nothing. Okay, if I look at Gomez, and if I look at the one who won, which was John's daughter, okay, there's hers, Sabador, the one who was directly in front of us. And I'm mainly doing this so that I can analyze it after I finish doing this report. So Alex Rogers was the one in front of us, and that will do for that. Okay, chart mode. So that shows you all of the relevant information there. Lap charts, position. Okay, track water. Pit stop history, gap to leader, position tracker, live timings. That is definitely something that I want to see. I want to see all of the fastest laps. And more importantly, I want to see the event results. So we can see the total time there and the gap to the leaders. Now, Gerard, oh, he got a fastest lap bonus. Under the rules, you get a bonus in terms of your points. What is this? Drive-through penalty. One penalty received. Okay, so that's what happened there. He got a drive-through penalty. Plus one lap. So at least we're on the same lap, I suppose. That's something. Continue. This is the scrutineering process that I told you about in the previous episode. No risk for us because we don't have any parts that have any risky components. And we come back to the original list of place getters and their times. We shall continue out of that. Drivers' Championship standings. So Faith is at 17th, Gomez is at 20th because he crashed. The team standings should be next, and as expected, we are 10th. We are only 2 points behind Archer BMR, and if Gomez hadn't crashed, who knows. But on the other hand, it was Gomez crashing that gave us the opportunity to put Anthony into the pits, get the parts fixed, and so she performed a lot better than she might have otherwise, so... There's no point in wondering about the what-ifs. John Stotter was definitely pushed to her limits during the race in the Black Sea. I don't really care. That's not about us. Try spending less money on helicopters and jacuzzis and more on your cars, Kirkus Octavius. I don't have any helicopters. Shut up, Max. I want to see Scuderia Quantistica at the top. Yes, so do I. I just love those guys. Yeah, so do I, except for my drivers and one of my mechanics. Obviously, I like Gary. Faith Anthony is so hot. In love. You're welcome to her. Honestly, you're welcome to her. I had a few good tussles at 150 miles per hour out there. Life in the midfield can be fun. Oh, shut up. All the rest are from the practice session. So we continue there. Okay, well, that actually wasn't as bad as I feared. I managed to keep talking all the way through that, and I have no idea what it'll sound like at the end of it. I might have just been talking complete drivel, but we shall see. When developing next season's car, you may find some team manufacturers have pre-existing agreements in place. For example, Steinman and Windsor provide discounts to each other. Okay, we are a long way off having to worry about that, and more importantly, I haven't encountered that yet. Now, this is the end of race results and the impact. Gomez's morale's dropped by 4.81%, as you would expect. If you plant a car into a wall, it tends not to have a very good impact on your morale. However, he has improved his relationship with Gary by 1.45%, so that's up to 3.45%, which is still pretty low. Faith has got a morale boost of 10.82% because she did moderately well at the end, but the only reason that she was doing moderately well was because Gomez's crash allowed us to make a pit stop, which allowed her to push the car unrealistically hard. The advantage of that is that at least it means that when we do start getting some decent parts, maybe we'll start getting some decent performance. Now you'll notice that there are changes down here. If you have drivers who have growth potential, after a race they'll usually get experience which will cause an increase in their stats, hopefully an increase. But of course these two have no growth potential, and that's the reason why it increases. Now for some reason Enano's abilities actually decreased, possibly because he didn't get a drive, but for whatever reason, I mean he's got basically no skills in the first place, he's got no place to grow, so I don't know, maybe he's already peaked. Oh no, he's only 26. That's still possible. Some people do peak very early. Thomas. Oh yes, expected result was 10th, you came 10th. Oh, jolly good. That improves my happiness by 6%. You're easily pleased, Thomas, and I'm glad to hear that you are. There's been no change to our marketability. We're still at 37%. I need more sponsors. I need more money. Actually, I need more money is also my mantra in real life, but okay. Continue. So this gives us a financial breakdown. Well, at least you're keeping the books fairly well balanced. No, I'm not. We're 1.173 down. Thankfully, the insurance covers Gomez's car, so we're okay for that. This basically just shows you the amounts that I showed you before practice last week. There's the 70,000. So tyre supply cost is 10,000. Tyre type cost is 10,000. Travel cost 30,000 and fuel cost 20,000. That's an awful lot of fuel. And then I do, for some reason, get a discount on that as well from my skills, so I'm not going to knock that back. Current balance is 11.36, and now it's going to drop to 10.192. Next we get a rundown of what's happened in the first round of the World Motorsport Championship. This is really too far away for us to be particularly concerned. The only reason that you would be interested in this is if you were near the top of a competition and you needed to see what was going to happen in the next competition up. Scuderia Rossini. I know who that would be based on. I can make a pretty fairly well-educated guess. And certainly not based on Scuderia Quantistica. Next, the Asia Pacific Super Cup. That's possibly of more interest to us, because we might be wanting to hire some of the drivers down there. Now, this is a point that I wanted to make as well. I made it in, I think it was the last episode. In some competitions, you don't get points for every place. So in this case, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The top 6 get points. Oh, the number's actually down there. Everybody else gets 0. So no matter how well you do, it doesn't really matter if you came 18th or whether you came 8th, you're still getting 0 points. Continue. And we know which race this is. We don't need reminding which race this is. The European Racing Series. Let's just pretend that it never happened. Continue. Next race is in 24 days in Munich. We have a fair amount to do. First, we have 4 emails that we need to read. Car condition update. Gary's currently our best parts fixer, and that's disturbing because his parts fixing, as opposed to his development skills, are not so great. Well, that really wasn't the ideal weekend from our point of view. Every email after the race starts like that. We're going to be working on the cars for a while. I know. This is what we need a certain mechanic of my acquaintance for, because she has really good skills on that. Here's the average amount of condition that we lost. Gomez's car lost 86% on average. I'm surprised it's only 86, because when you smack something into a concrete wall and it catches on fire, it tends not to survive the experience particularly well. Faith's dropped 44% on average. Time to fix is 51 hours, so that's over 2 days. And until they fix it, then Gary can't work on any of the development either. Once this work is complete, the mechanics will move back to the usual tasks on performance and reliability. So effectively what that means is the factory is locked up. We can't do anything about improving parts. Next up is an interview with JTV Sport. Now, like I said, very rarely does anything come out of these interviews that's good. But let's see what she wants to ask, because we can't afford the risk that it'll impact on our marketing if I go and hide in my office. Gomez has claimed that your brakes seem to be holding the team back. Maybe if you used them in the last race, Gomez, you would find that they actually slow the car down and stop it before it hits the bloody wall. And technical commentators seem to agree. Is it true? I have to hold my hands up. Our brakes are awful and I need to work on improving them. That's not my priority at the moment. It's my number three priority after getting us decent engines and decent gearboxes. And then I can work on some brakes. Unless you would care to dig into your ample pockets, Gomez, and fund the development of some new brakes. He needs to button it. This will hit his morale. We need more investment in our HQ, really. That's the heart of the problem. Well, it sort of is. But in reality, we can't develop it any faster than we're developing it anyway. That answer would actually annoy Thomas. That answer, I think, would affect our marketability. That answer will hit Gomez's morale, and if he can't keep his bloody mouth shut, he deserves to have his morale hit. Bang! 5% drop in his morale. So next time, Gomez, shut up! An overall report on the win in the Black Sea, which I really don't want to know about. What's coming up on the calendar? Black Sea race interview. I don't want to know. Car condition update, we've already seen. The Asia Pacific Super Cup, the Singapore race, we saw the results for those. And Vancouver, which was in WMC. Rachel, give me some good news, Rachel. Please give me some good news. Oh, thank God. Finally, you've come to your senses. Can we please get back to work? I need you down in the factory to do the part repairs and help Gary out. Staff. Shut up, Max. Details. I'm not going to retract the offer. Okay, so finally she's delighted with the cost per race. Actually, I probably could have knocked that back one notch and still gotten her. She's neutral about the contract length because she didn't want to be locked in for that long. At her age, I have no idea why, because you're really looking for longer contracts the older you get. Buyout clause, she's fine with. The signing on fee, she is fine with. Sign her up. Replace Santiago. Go give Gary a hand in the factory. $157,000. Just go do it. Go do it. Very good. Very good, finally. Okay, so she's paired with Gomez. That's okay. That's okay. I don't think it actually matters which one is paired with which. Rachel, I think, has better chemistry, actually. Let's take a look at that. No, no, her chemistry is only 6. I think Gary is actually a more affable mechanic. Yeah, he's got a chemistry of 9. So, yeah, okay, we'll leave them to it. How's Freddie doing? If we look at the car, so Freddie will be ready with the engine in 1 day and 22 hours. I don't know whether the car is going to be fixed earlier than we originally predicted, now that Rachel's on the team, because her skills at part fixes are better. But we'll worry about that when the time comes. Scuderia Quantistica. Oh, this one. Hi, Kirkus. It's brilliant to have joined you here at Scuderia Quantistica. Looking forward to getting work on improving the car. Shut up, Max. Scuderia Quantistica sign Rachel McAndrew as their new race mechanic. That's fine, but for the moment, she's of more value to me in the factory. Headquarters. How long have we got? 12 weeks to the staff centre, 17 weeks to the factory. Let's start the calendar ticking over. I'll go forward. Okay, so tomorrow the car repair will still be complete and the engine design will be finished. Okay, so pause. Okay, Astrid Olberg has joined ZRT as their new race mechanic. The 24-year-old will be working with Dembele, and that's obviously they're replacing Rachel. Car repair finished. Thank you, Gary. I expect to be getting those from Rachel in future because she is the better mechanic in that particular respect. So that means we can get back to improving parts. So, what do we need to do? First part is, we want to make absolutely sure that we're not improving the wrong engine, which is, at the moment, is what we're doing. So, get that out. Because the thing is, we'll obviously be using this engine and we will be using the new one that Freddy's going to be delivering to us later today. So that's 75%. Okay, let's take a look and see what the chief mechanic impact is here. I think we're still going to want Gary in here. Her chief mechanic impact is 0.2 on reliability. And Gary's is 0.6 on reliability. Hers is 0.3 on performance, and Gary's is 0.8. Okay, so we know that Gary's the better mechanic at development. I think I'm going to leave him on... No, I want him on reliability. The reason that I want him on reliability is because weight stripping. Weight stripping is where the action's going to be. Munich, acceleration, low speed corners, medium speed corners. Okay. Performance. We need the gearboxes up to speed. We also need suspension, acceleration. Acceleration is crucial. So she'll be done 8 days before the race anyway. Gary would be done on that 3 days before the race. But what is lower? Actually, nothing else is lower. That's 71%. That is the worst. We don't want him to do anything on that. We actually want him to be working on the new engine when it arrives. 71, 74, 70 on that gearbox. Okay. You can work on the same part in both the performance and the reliability teams. You'll notice that by adding that, it's moved the completion time to 15 days after the race. Because even a mechanic like Gary can only work so fast and these parts are not in good condition at all. So the staff impact is 1.5. Yeah. Yep. Once he's done with that, I'm going to have to pull him off those. I'm going to have to pull him off those as soon as the new engine arrives. And I will put him straight onto the new engine because we need that up to a reasonable amount. Because that is going to be the best part that we have. Let's move forward by a few days. What's coming up? Okay, nothing's coming up on the calendar in the immediate future. 22nd. Why did we stop? Car. Oh, that's why we stopped. Because Freddy's finished the engine. Alrighty. So that being the case... Okay, Gary, dump those. Get to work on the reliability on the engine. No, dump both of them. I need you concentrating on the engine. I need that up to about 70%. And in fact, I'm going to give you more staff to do it as well. So, that's going to slow Rachel down a fair amount. But it doesn't matter because that engine's going to be critical. Even though top speed is actually not critical there, the fact that we have an engine which is only 4 out of 7, 8 out of 12, that's not competitive. Actually, that's what I want to do too. If we look at our standings, if we go back to the car, Right, we're still 10th. We're still 10th. Oh, far out. We are still 10th, even with Freddy's new engine. But it's put a heck of a bump into there. So, Freddy, I'm running a heck of a risk here, my friend, because I am short on money, but I need you to build me a second engine. So again, we will go for top speed of plus 20, and we will go for this part, which is top speed of plus 25. I would kind of like to go for that one, but we couldn't do that until the end of the season, because it's got that risk level associated with it. So I'll sacrifice 5 points of performance for plus 5 in reliability. That's 1.65. It'll be finished 5 days before the race. 5 days before the race is still not going to be enough time for us to get it into service for the race. And you see that that plus 5 reliability has actually just bumped that reliability up to 5%. It's not a permanent increase. It just means that there's 5%, or 5 percentage points less work that the team has to do in the factory. The great components, which is next, top speed of plus 60, but a risk level of plus 1. Risk level of minus 1, but a cost of 1 million. And top speed 20 to max. That means that the maximum, which is currently 78, the difference, I think I explained previously, between the current best and the actual maximum best depends on the improvability stat of your chassis. In this case, it is... Oh, actually, that's minus 20. No, we don't want that. Top speed of plus 40. Okay, I've never seen a minus to max. Okay, a plus to max would mean that that top value would increase. However, all of this is academic because you cannot build great parts unless you have a specialist parts development facility at your headquarters, which in the case of engines is the test track. So if by some miracle we had enough money to build a third engine, which we do not, we would probably be building it with a couple of extra parts down here, maybe two of the average components. We get plus 10 there. Is that plus 10? Yeah, plus 10. So plus 20, plus 10, plus 10 on the reliability, and another one of these, plus 25, plus 5. Okay, so that comes up to 66 out of 73. So the 66 comes from 2 from base, 19 from designer, 45 from components. Freddy, build my engine! Oh, I hate spending that sort of money. Thomas is going to be in my ear again over this, I know it. 17 days, 22 hours. Go for it, my friend. Go for it. Okay, it may be a bit abrupt, but I want to draw this episode to a conclusion at the moment. First, because I want to get these back under an hour, which I haven't succeeded in doing today, but we'll try for next week. And also, I noticed that I was starting to meander a bit at the end of this one, which is one of the reasons for doing these videos, which is I want to cure myself of that sort of bad habit before I start getting back to my bread and butter ones. I will try to pick up the pace in episode 6, which will lead us to the race in Munich, a town which features both boxers and beer kellers, a combination that never goes well. But for now, that's your bite for this weekend, so until next time, have a great weekend, and goodbye.